these people in the community, they're dedicated to Node. You know, they're dedicated in their free time to Node, and you know, they're dedicated enough to take a day off from work and go and do this other consulting thing if it's going to help people do better with Node.
What sort of clients would you expect to have? I mean, are you thinking large enterprises or startups?
So I can tell you like the kind of approaches we had so far. We already have like 5 to 10 emails of companies that are really serious about getting our services, and they're dramatically different, to be surprising. For instance, we had talks with people that are trying to port a Facebook application that they run on PHP because they think that the streaming model is going to really help them deliver more music in real time. Or we have a large blogging network from Chile that might be interested in talking to us and actually migrate their things to Node, and they want to know that they can do it right, that it actually works, so they can get our expertise to actually know, so does this work and how do we do it? How do we pull it off? So we think that enterprise will be more interested in this, so maybe telcos or energy, but we're at this point not sure, but those are the kind of companies that are right now reaching out to us, companies that want to migrate to Node, and they recognize that there is this gap, and they're like, okay, you're leveraging the gap that I was really afraid of. Please come here and help me do this. Your team can help us.
Yeah, we've had a few people already make a comment like, this is exactly what we need, actually. And I think, you know, we are going to stretch the scale between startups and enterprise, I think. I think we're going to get a few big customers that really want us to go in and, you know, do a training for like 30 people so that they can all learn Node. And then we're also going to get a lot of startups that really need architecture help or early code review so that they're not doing things that just aren't kind of best practices. But I think that the key difference here between our services and what you might hire traditional consulting services for, and where we wouldn't fit into that, is you need to have a development team of your own. You know, like we're providing services that invest in your team. You know, we're not providing the team for you, we're not writing the code for you. So, you know, a lot of traditional consulting services go to people who have a great idea for a product, and they might have a great design, or they might have great content, but they don't have any developers, and so they hire a consulting firm to do that, and that's not what we're going to do at all.
Do you know of any precedent for this type of firm, like with any other language? I mean, it seems like a pretty novel idea.
Not a lot of other languages, but I think some of the services that we provide are a fraction of what other consulting services have done in the past. Particular smaller consulting companies that tend to be involved in really early technologies, you know, like Boaz Sender is a very good friend of mine at Boku, who runs like a very successful consulting firm, and they're doing everything from WebGL HTML5 games to, you know, like phenomenal new stuff with Backbone, and they were one of the first people to sort of do stuff with Node and with Couch, and they really like to invest in really new technologies and take really exciting contracts, and they take longer term contracts, that's their business, but every once in a while they will do a training, or, you know, they will just go in and do one day of on-site something for somebody because, you know, they get that opportunity, but they can't really specialize in it or only do it because, you know, they want to employ those people full time and they want to take on that other work. And it's a lot of work to negotiate with companies who want to pay you to come in for a day, right? And having a lot of overhead in that negotiation and in that billing process to do it, you know, hundreds of times a month or possibly, is just not what they want to do, you know. Like, Boaz definitely does not want to spend all of his time doing, you know, accounting work.
So a thing like, you're right that this is a novelty, but it's in a novelty in the sense that the community is running this. It is not necessarily a novelty in enterprise. If you look at enterprises that sell very well to enterprise markets, but because they are in such tip top of the enterprise, there's not a lot of developers that know how to do that kind of technology. Well, those kind of companies, software companies, normally provide professional services that look a lot like these to get people ramped up. So that exists a lot in the industry. It's just that normally there's like a big company that actually owns the technology that does these kind of things. And here you have kind of the inverted ways, like the community, the actual experts are scattered across different companies, and the companies just agree that it's in everyone's benefit to actually go and still help the customer succeed, even though it's a technology that is still emerging.
Okay. Mm-hmm. You mentioned one of the things that you would be able to help people out with are avoiding common pitfalls. What are some of the pitfalls or scenarios that you've seen a lot?
I mean, certain things that you think would be really obvious by using the API a lot, really simple things, you know, like when I create a new API that takes a callback, it needs to have the standard callback parameter, you know, one error and one success result callback. And a lot of people, you know, they still won't use those in their own code. Like, they'll use them constantly when they're using libraries, but then when they write their own code in their own API, they'll never give it an argument, or they'll pass it null when there's an error, and that's a really, really bad pattern to try and do. You can't mix and match that very well with the core API. You end up swallowing errors when you don't mean to. And, you know, most importantly, you're not able to use a lot of the value that's being created on top of Node in the user community because you're not following the same patterns. A lot of other patterns that you see is that people end up rewriting things because they just didn't know about a library that's out there. You know, I think a lot of our early advisory stuff is going to be telling people about Dnode, or, you know, telling people about Socket.io and how you can integrate that with Redis and do sort of distributed real-time stuff. A lot of people just aren't comfortable enough knowing that these things exist and end up trying to go and rewrite them when there's a really good one that's really battle-tested and being used across a bunch of companies in production that they just don't know about because it hasn't been big enough for their people to see it yet.
Okay. Did you have anything to add?
There's also companies that want to be more involved in the community because they feel like it's safer for them if they're heavily involved in the community and understand what's going on. And I think like this kind of skill will complement what they have. They feel like they can do it, but they feel like it would be good if they had an entry point to the community where they feel really safe. For instance, if they're doing a private NPM store, if they can talk to Isaac, well, Isaac can actually listen to them and help them not only set that up, but he can only maybe reason about something that is missing on NPM that would allow people to have more private registries. So they can get that engagement point that they need in the community because these are open source modules. So they can hook up to open source modules that they couldn't ever do because they were just open source and some handle on the internet. Now they can meet this person and talk with them. So that's also something that people are, or at least they told me that it looks very interesting about the Node firm.
Yeah, and we also hope that eventually a lot of this, the feedback that we get by having these new relationships with new startups and enterprises, we want to feed that information back into the community. You know, like I run a bunch of meetups and we're going to keep doing even more. You know, I run a conference for Node. Like, knowing what problems people are running into the most is going to be the best content to have at events like, you know, meetups and conferences and stuff like that, so that we can start to spread this knowledge more. I mean, like, one of the goals of the firm is that eventually any company that we work with won't have to use our services, you know? And hopefully in the future, like, you won't even need services like this because everybody, the community will be so grown and involved that you can hire really good people and that everybody's connected.
Okay, so Node's been around for, it seems like 3 years now, about, and this is the afternoon of the second day of this event, so there's certain things that we've probably heard a lot over and over again by now. So I'm kind of wondering, what are you guys, what common misperceptions are you guys tired of hearing about? What errors are there in the community that you would like to maybe set people straight?
Wow, so much. I think like one of the biggest things that I've heard over and over again is the event model. It's all about the event model, and like, I really think that most of the people that are talking about that are thinking about the event model from a different language, because like, yeah, we have these asynchronous I/O patterns in Node, but when you're in Node, when you sort of internalize the Node way of doing things, the way that you think about the problem is actually like all I/O is in callbacks, you know, and all events are actually, you know, when you call emit, that's like a blocking in memory operation, and all the listeners have to do something right now, and then you're going to move on and do something else. And so events in Node actually are this thing that's not entirely asynchronous. Like, yes, when I add a listener to it, it's going to happen sometime in the future, but calling that event is actually not deferred until later and doesn't enter into the event loop. I'm trying to think about a lot of other things that I have problems with, and I should probably not get into too many of them.
Yeah, I think what I'm excited about is that people start focusing on problems that Node can solve really well, network problems that have like high traffic and that can really help companies like do businesses that they can't. I've already heard stories about companies that are trying, they have huge Java stacks and they just can't deliver as much information as they need to because of the impedance of all these huge frameworks. And Node is just such a lean way of getting your network programs to deliver so much information. I'm super excited about that. So sometimes I don't get very excited when people go like and are doing something that, for instance, is very CPU intensive or is just very huge case that you should just use Apache to serve static files because it's already there, it's very solid, or Nginx, so that's kind of it.
I think that the only other thing that I would bring up is that because the focus of the conference is on, you know, getting a lot of people in the business world and the venture capital world comfortable with Node and understanding Node, knowing about Node, all the focus is on core and sort of like what Node offers in core and as a technology and how that changes things. But you know, there's an order of magnitude more value being created right now on top of Node in the module community, in things, you know, like we have the best package manager that I've ever used across any language or platform before. And, you know, people haven't really mentioned it that much, you know. This is like one of the reasons why I've heard people come to Node is because this package manager is so nice. And NPM is just amazing. And NPM's enabled us to build all these other great new modules, you know, like Socket.io, like Express, like Dnode, you know. They solve all these amazing problems, and we haven't spent a lot of time talking about that to Summit.
Well, we have to take a break now, but thanks a lot for your time, guys.
Thank you.
Good luck with the Node firm.
Yeah, thanks.
Hi, I'm Clint Finley with SiliconANGLE. We're here live on theCUBE, which is our streaming broadcast internet TV show. We cover all the latest and greatest in technology. Today we're in San Francisco at the first Node Summit, which is dedicated to Node.js, which is an emerging development platform. I'm joined today by Arnout Kazimir. He's the founder of Observit. Arnout, can you tell us a little bit about Observit?
Observit is a real-time analytics service that's not analyzing your website, but your users. So you're actually insert one line of code in your page, and you can see the users' mouse everywhere on your page, and see the clicks and scroll down the page, and you see that reflected on your own browser. So it's just like watching over the shoulder of your user.
And so, would you compile a lot of statistics from this, or is this just you record a lot of the interactions? How does the end user who's analyzing the traffic, how do they use it?
We're sending all the events to our backend, and then you can replay it, just like separate session, or it gets aggregated as heat maps.
Okay. And so you were one of the winners of Node Knockout, the most recent Node.js development competition. Which categories did you win in?
We won overall, solo, and utility.
So you developed the original one solo, all in your own?
Solo.
Okay. What's your background before starting this project?
I'm originally a designer, and then I moved from designing to the front end. And then when Node started getting traction, I moved to Node.
Okay, so you're solving the sort of problem that you would face then as a web developer wanting to know how people are interacting with sites and applications.
Yeah, how they're doing on your site and what is working and what is not working.
Okay,
how users are converting on your website as well.
How do you use Node.js in this?
Our complete services runs on Node.js. We're using Socket.io for the real-time connection between the user and our server. Mm-hmm. And we're using Node Canvas to generate heat maps. And we're using the Q service from LearnBoost to process all the information in real-time.
Hey, is this something that the end user has to opt into, or is this something that it just starts getting recorded?
It just starts getting recorded, so you have to put a little privacy notes in your page that users might be monitored.
And so this is all done in JavaScript, so there's nothing that the end user has to even download. It's just part of...
Just one line of code in your page and you're done.
How well does it perform then? Does it slow the site down?
It doesn't slow down the site because we're using WebSockets to send over the information. But of course, you have a little performance hit because you have to download one extra script on your page.
Well, what about on the user's end?
You won't feel any latency when you're moving around on a page.
Okay. Will it increase the CPU usage or anything like that?
No, nope.
Not
noticeably. Not a bit. Yeah, maybe like 1-2%. But
okay.
It's not noticeable.
So, where are you going with this application now? I know you're part of the Node competition here.
Yeah.
So are you looking for funding? Do you have funding?
We're definitely looking for funding. We're currently just bootstrapping the application. And we're just we're hoping to build it out as a complete service. And by looking for investors, we can just push out the public release sooner.
What's the business model going to look like? Will this be sort of a freemium service that people can, you know, you have an entry-level tier?
Yeah, we have an entry-level that's like 100 recordings, and then you have to pay for a monthly fee.
Okay. What's on your roadmap for the development? Is there any... do you have any longer-term vision for what else you want to do with
it? Yeah, we definitely want to continue aggregating the data and getting more useful data out of it, like where your users all are dropping, so you don't have to follow one session to find out, but just an aggregated view of possible interesting sessions for you. And we want to go mobile. It's the new hot thing, so following touches mm-hmm. and emulating that as well.
Okay, so I want to go back a little bit to your background, because you said you started out as a designer, and then you started doing front-end development, and now you're doing back-end development with Node. How hard were each of those transitions?
From designing to front-end was quite easy, because I just always wanted to have my designs pixel perfect. So you just have to do it yourself if you want a pixel perfect web pages. And then yeah, Node came, and I just wanted to move on, keep on learning, and it was just a smooth transition from front end to back end. It's just the same language everywhere, which makes it really easy to work with.
Is the whole callback model, is that hard to learn?
I don't think so. It's just something to get used to, but once you know how it works and what kind of issue you're going to run into, like these funky call stack trees with nested callbacks everywhere. Mm-hmm. Because if you just know how to avoid it, it's just simple.
Were there, as you were developing Observe It, did you run into any big stumbling blocks with Node, or did everything just work pretty seamlessly?
The only problem that we had was with hosting, that they're not all supporting WebSockets. So that's something we were bumping against, because the WebSocket spec kept changing and changing, and not every hosting company can keep updating their stack to support the current WebSocket.
Right, and well, not all browsers. Well, are all the major browsers supporting WebSockets now?
Yeah,
I know
that's true.
Mozilla took it out for a while, but they put it back in.
Yeah.
Opera is supporting it now?
Opera is supporting it, okay. Chrome, Safari.
Has the development of it stabilized then, of the spec?
The spec is finalized, so that's okay. That's great news. But there are always some issues with cross-browser support, even with WebSockets.
Okay.
There are bugs everywhere, so you just got to be aware of those issues.
So that seems more like it's more of a front-end issue rather than a Node.js issue.
Yeah, that's
or not true. Even not a front-end issue, but just
yeah. But you also got to make sure that that your back-end of Node is up to date with all the different WebSocket protocols. Because we got really old versions of Safari that's using like Draft 75, and the newer one using the latest WebSocket specifications, and you want to support them all to have a great browser support range.
Okay. Well, that's all the questions I have. Is there anything else you wanted to let our viewers know about?
No, they can sign up for a beta on beta.observe.it, and we're rolling out a beta next week, slowly.
Great. Well, good luck with the beta.
Yeah, thanks.
Right. We're going to take a break.
The Cube is this conceptual box, if you will, and we bring people inside of the Cube, and then we share ideas, but those ideas don't stay inside the Cube. We explode that idea. We allow that idea to grow and grow, and it does. So we really try to own the whole enterprise technology space. I mean, that's what we're all about. We take analysis, we take publishing, we take news, and we take live TV, and we combine it together in a product and share that with our community.
No one's doing what we're doing. What we're doing, in my opinion, is the future of media, future of television, future of the internet. Video is an amazing, powerful product.
So we work in what John and I talk about as a data model. People always say to us, well, how do you guys make money? We sell knowledge, we sell information, we sell data.
So the problem that we identified is about what we call big, fast, total data. Anybody can analyze a gigabyte of data. If you do 1,000 gigabytes, that's a terabyte of data. You take 1,000 terabytes, that's a petabyte of data. 1,000 petabytes, that's a zettabyte of data. So you are talking big data, lots and lots of data, and can you analyze it in real time as it comes in, right?
The Cube is like, we call ESPN of tech, because we want to cover technology like ESPN covers sports.
John has a great vision for what's going to happen next in tech. And so John is sort of that alter ego of mine that lets me see the future.
We have a really amazing team of people that work with us.
Michael Sean Wright, Mark Hopkins, you know, we've got Kiem here today. We've got a team of people on our news desk run by Kristen Nicole. So she has a team that help feed us the news of the day, what's happening, the analysis. We have a team of analysts, and they feed us information about what's happening. And then, really importantly, we have a community, a big community of many hundreds of contributors.
We love technology, we love the innovation, and that's what we do. We want to create a great user experience. And in order to do that properly, you've got to really, really prepare. The Cube, for the past year that we've been in operation, has been very, very successful. And you know, companies do pay us to come here. I think companies who bring us in with the Cube get two things. They get a third-party independent resource to provide knowledge to their audience who are seeking it, this demand for the product. And also complements their existing media. We're here at an event, and the company has their own TV organization, and they have to pay a premium for that. So we complement that by offering a objective, organic, third-party, independent analysis of the event. That's why the top executives come in here. The Cube is a comfortable place. It's a place where people feel happy and are happy to share their knowledge with the world. And we're happy to be ambassadors of that knowledge transfer.
My entire career has been really built on relationships and talking to people and extracting knowledge from people, largely in a belly-to-belly private forum. What theCUBE does is it explodes that to a huge audience. I mean, we've reached millions with theCUBE, and it's real-time, it's live TV, so you've got to be quick on your feet, but you learn very fast, and then you iterate from that learning. So John and I play off of that, and we're constantly trying to up our game.
I'm Clint Finley with SiliconANGLE. We're here live on theCUBE at Node Summit in San Francisco. This is the first Node Summit. It's dedicated to the new development language or development platform, Node.js, which uses JavaScript as a server-side programming language. I'm joined today by Tim Caswell. He's the community manager at Cloud9 IDE. And before that, he was involved with porting Node.js to WebOS, HP's mobile operating system, and he's been involved with the Node community since the earliest days. He also runs a website called How to Node, which has various tutorials on Node.js, and he's really active at Cloud9 and evangelizing Node and helping people learn about Node. So, Tim, we just start off with, okay, with you talking a little bit about what attracted you to Node in the first place and why you got so excited about it.
Okay. So at the time, I was working in just a PHP web development job. We had to support IE6 and old version of PHP. And as a developer, that was rather painful to me. So in my free time, I'd go home and just experiment with new technologies. And V8 had just come out, and I thought it was a cool technology for JavaScript. So I was looking for someone doing V8 on the server. And I looked around on Google and I found this project called V8CGI, and there were a few others. And basically they were all trying to take the same model that Python and Ruby does and do it in JavaScript on the server. And I'm like, that's not very interesting. And they were kind of buggy and they weren't really supported. And then I came across Ryan's website, nodejs.org. And there he had this radically different object event model, where it's non-blocking I/O, just like the browser has. And I'm like, now that's something different. That's something cool. And so I started using it. It actually worked, more or less. I mean, back in this day, Node's API changed almost daily. But it was really fun. And so I just got hooked on it. I started writing modules for it because it didn't have anything. I needed a database, and at the time I was using Postgres. So I implemented the Postgres protocol in JavaScript so Node could talk to the database. And just went from there over the years. I've just been using it ever since.
Yeah, so one of the things you built was How to Node, which runs on your own blogging engine that you wrote in Node.js,
right.
Is that
right?
And you've open sourced that. That's on GitHub.
Yes.
And it uses Git as its backend, or as its database?
Correct. So How to Node is just... It takes a Git repo, and there's an article, there's a folder called articles, there's a folder called authors, and they're written in Markdown. It assumes a certain structure, and then whenever a web request comes in, it will figure out which SHA, because you can put the Git SHA in the URL, and so you can read an article at any version of history, and it will render as HTML. So it's actually not that different from how GitHub itself works when you're just browsing a project, except it's rendered like a blog. And then the comments and everything else is just using an external service. And so the Node engine is just rendering HTML.
And what's the name of that platform?
So that's the Wheat engine.
Wheat engine. Is anyone else using that yet?
Yeah, it's been used. I've seen about 5 or 6 different blogs use it. I recognize it because they usually don't change my CSS style. And I'm like, I recognize that theme.
Cool.
And I never meant for Wheat to be a program for other people to use. I just open sourced it because I figured, well, it might be useful to someone. And then now people use it.
Yeah, that seems to be a pretty common story with Node.js stuff.
Right.
So the main thing I really wanted to talk to you about, though, is what your advice is for developers who want to learn Node.js, because as we just talked earlier with Michael Rogers and Ninu Jobs from the Node firm, in which you're also involved in.
Right.
And there's just, a big shortage of Node talent. So, how can people who want to learn Node get up to speed?
So if you want to learn Node, I think a very good place to start is you need to understand what Node is good for and what Node is not good for. A lot of people come to Node with misconceptions about what it's used for, and it's just not good. And over the years, the one thing that I've discovered is that people new to Node often don't know JavaScript as well as they thought they did. In the browser, like you have these experienced developers who've done front-end development, maybe for years and years, and they're really good at it. But in the browser, there is very little actual asynchronous work. You have a mouse event, and you react to that. You have a key press event, you react to that. You may go do some AJAX, give it a callback, and get the result. But that's it. In the browser, you don't want to make an AJAX and then depend on that, do another AJAX and then just have like 10 nested AJAX calls because the performance would be terrible. Because the latency on each of those calls can be like 500 milliseconds. So in the browser, there's very little of this nested asynchronous function pattern. And so people don't learn how to do that in JavaScript as well. And then they come to Node and they discover that, well, before there was FS read file, to open a file, you had to first do fs open, give it a callback, that would give you the file descriptor. And then you had to call fs read, give it an offset, give it the file descriptor, give it a buffer, and it was like one-to-one with the C API. And you'd have like this little recursive loop here and these nested callbacks here, and it was like 100 lines of code just to read a file. And people have a really hard time understanding the JavaScript that does that to be able to use the Node API. So I would highly recommend having a firm understanding of closures and callbacks, the run-to-completion model, the way that single-threaded event loops work, because the Node API itself is actually pretty simple. It's a very small API, it's very to the point, and it's easy to understand. That's not usually the hard issue. And then once your team has a good firm understanding of these parts of JavaScript, you can get a lot further.
How well do you need to know JavaScript before you start learning Node?
I mean, you can start learning right away. It's just...
Without any previous JavaScript experience?
Right. Like, I've taught a lot of people who have come to JavaScript because of Node, and sometimes they're easier to teach because they don't have preconceived notions. Luckily, Node's JavaScript model isn't that different from the browser, so that it's not too bad.
What resources would you point people to get started?
So there's good books on JavaScript. I have a lot of JavaScript articles on how to Node. I like Marian's book, the big yellow one, Eloquent JavaScript. It teaches ECMAScript 3, which is the older JavaScript, but it teaches the cores and the principles. That's a really good one for people who don't know JavaScript at all.
I love that book.
It's a good book.
The online version of it has the interactive
tutorials.
And it covers computer science in general and not just JavaScript. So introduces a lot of concepts. So somebody who's an absolute beginner, that's a really good place to start.
My favorite part of that book is actually in the intro. He has this paragraph that talks about what is programming. And what was the quote? He says, like, the art of programming is taming complexity. And this is extra true when you're dealing with a Node program because of the asynchronous nature of having callback continuations everywhere. Your biggest problem in scaling a Node program is not performance. Your biggest problem is keeping your code complexity sane and bug-free. And that really is the art of programming. And I'm glad that he teaches that. It's not just here's the syntax of JavaScript, this is what a function does.
So we have to take a break here pretty soon.
Okay.
So it's howtonode.com is your website?
Howtonode.org.
Howtonode.org and cloud9.com?
And the cloud9 one is nodebits.org.
Nodebits.org. Okay. Well, thanks a lot for
your time,
Tim.
Hi, Alex Williams here of SiliconANGLE here at the Node Summit. We're once again covering events like no one else. We're the leaders in this space without a doubt. Anyway, here with Paul Friedman of Streetlight Data.
Hello.
Paul, how are you doing today?
Excellent. It's a good day for startups.
Good. So let's start off with Node.js. Tell me how you're using it. And first of all, tell us a little bit about your company.
So Streetlight Data is a data as a service company, and we're focused on information about sort of where, when, why, and how are people moving throughout the real world. Like if you compare the information that companies have about, you know, what's going on their website, who's visiting, what they're looking at, where their mouse is, and, you know, there's just a wealth of information about what's going on in the online world. But in the real world, Starbucks could never tell you who's driving by in front of their store, who's walking in versus who's not walking in on any given day. Mm-hmm.
So that's essentially the core of what you do?
That's exactly what we do. We sell information about, you know, where and when and why are people going on the real roadways in the real world. Who's driving, you know, past the store at different times of day? Where are cars breaking down? Where should services be provisioned? Where should businesses be located?
So how do you use Node.js?
We don't right now, actually.
On the front end, then?
On the front end, so our front end is entirely written in JavaScript. Ext.js is the stack that we've built on. We're really leveraging a lot of good open source geospatial technologies. The Geo Server from the Open Geo folks has just been doing yeoman's work for us. Talend for doing bulk data movement and data integration has been fantastic. And the core backends that we've been using are Postgres with the PostGIS extensions and the big data stack from Cloudera for really handling the heavy lifting.
Okay. So what do you find unique about this event? I mean, you are talking about lots of data, and much of what we're hearing from the people speaking here is about real-time data and uses for Node.js to help with that.
Yeah, and the real-time component is definitely a big one for us. We have a mobile component that is streaming back real-time geospatial tracks of where people are driving, and as well as performance information. Are you taking that hard right turn? Are you driving like a madman, or are you, right, you know, driving like somebody's grandmother? That's streaming in real time and being fed into, right now, an array of PostGIS geospatial databases, which are then in sort of periodic, you know, we don't need to give Starbucks an up-to-date count of who drove by at that instant. They really need to know, you know, on average who's coming by that location so they can do a better job of site selection and planning. So we use bulk data movement via Talend to populate the big data stack of Hadoop.
Talend and Cloudera were two of our big data startups to watch this year.
Very much so. I think Gartner got it right on Talend. I actually did an evaluation of all the different open source ETL tools, and if I was going to pay for it, I'd go for Informatica, but in the world of lower cost open source, Talend beats everybody else hands down.
Why?
The completeness, the robustness of their technology, the extensibility of their technology, the breadth of the adapter support they provide out of the box.
The connectors?
The connectors, exactly. And with their version 5, the depth of the Hadoop and Hive support on big data is really superior.
Well, good. So you use Talend for that bulk data.
Yes.
What is that bulk data?
So the bulk data is the data after it's been sort of geospatially processed and normalized out of those Postgres databases, those PostGIS databases, where inside there we're taking all this noisy, dirty GPS data streaming off the mobile phones and cleaning it up to really see what road are you driving on, how fast are you driving. And that's the bulk data that we're pushing into a Hive data warehouse to do our larger analytics to enable people to say, okay, in this neighborhood, how safe are people driving, or where are women going shopping at 2 in the afternoon, and on what roads are they driving?
So, okay, so you're using So that's where the Hadoop integration comes into play.
Exactly. Just processing those, you know, millions upon millions of records of where and why people are driving. It's doing sort of classic data warehouse, big data analytics.
But you're using Cloudera.
We're leaning towards Cloudera right now, evaluated them against data stacks, and are leaning towards Cloudera.
Why?
I'd say robustness, completeness of the solution, and I think they're just a little further along. I like the failure support, the sort of failure mode and sort of greater reliability of data stacks, but I think Cloudera's got the edge, and with their relational integration via the Oracle partnership and others, I think it's better suited.
What
for
about
us.
Other big data storage options out there? I mean, there's more distributed storage options available now.
Yep, evaluated the one that's being spun out of LexisNexis right now. They've got a large storage option.
Right. HPCC.
Exactly, HPCC. Looked at that. A little too proprietary, a little sort of too closed of an environment is what we saw.
But they've opened it up.
They have, but it's still early. We got one of the earlier evaluation copies last year of that. It's a question of will that gain traction? Will it catch on? And will the ecosystem grow for that? Where the generic Hadoop stack is definitely being embraced by the big data vendors. I mean, I'd hate to be sitting in Teradata's shoes today.
Well, I'd like to get to that. But, you know, there's other distributed storage options like Red Hat Cluster. You could use Red Hat Cluster, and they're going to be integrating that into OpenShift as well.
Yep. For us, we like the Hive sort of pseudo-relational layer on top of it. We're not looking for sort of a pure tag value type of a store, which a lot of the stacks have been focused on, because we want to do sort of real classic data warehouse, data mart type queries where we're doing aggregated calculations on the data. There's also a lot more sort of knowledge out there for sort of SQL and SQL-like support in terms of code generation, in terms of JDBC integration and front-end connectivity. So trying to stay as sort of relational-like as we can.
Wow, so you guys have really explored this. We only have a few minutes left. Let's end it just on where you guys are going with the company and how, you know, you're going to, you know, really adapt to that geospatial element that really is part of the data that you're collecting.
Oh, it's core to our business, because we need to know where people are, what road you're driving on, what the weather was at that point in time and at that point in space, and the other external factors, so that not only is time an important dimension, but location is a critical dimension for us. And we found that the open source and academic community support for that is just fantastic. But it hasn't percolated its way up into the big data stacks yet. So we're still relying on the relational databases to do that geospatial processing.
That's tough.
As soon as somebody supports over to Hadoop and or Hive some really good GIS support, we'll be all over that.
There's an opportunity there. Well, thank you very much, Paul, for taking some time to talk with us.
No, thank you.
Paul Friedman of Streetlight Data, the Chief Technology Officer. I'm Alex Williams with SiliconANGLE. We'll be right back from the Node Summit.
Hi, I'm Alex Williams of SiliconANGLE, where we are the leader in tech event coverage, and here today with John Sheehan, and I see a friend of ours off to the side, Stephen O'Grady. Can you come on and join us? So Stephen's going to join us. Stephen is a well-known analyst in the community with Redbunk. They are famous for their being extremely focused on developers. I don't know if you guys have met before.
Hey, John, nice to meet you.
Yeah, likewise.
So why don't we just talk about what you guys did, some of the impressions that you get from this event. You guys both were on stage today over the past 2 days. So, John, why don't we start with you? What are some of your impressions of Node.js, its maturity, what you're seeing of Node, what gets you excited about where this is going or maybe not?
Okay. I think on the maturity level, I think we've reached the point where it's not only technically mature, but also sort of the ecosystem is starting to mature around it in a way that it's no longer maybe a detriment or hard to find people to work on Node. So there's plenty of developers, there's plenty of service providers, there's a lot of other resources other than just a good solid technology that are really starting to take Node to the next level and help it thrive. And I think that's been the most impressive thing that I've seen is just all of the surrounding ecosystem type things.
Stephen?
Yeah, I mean, certainly I would agree. You know, one of the interesting sort of phenomena we observed over the last year, you know, we started writing about Node, I want to say in 2009, you know, maybe 2010. You know, so the sort of ascent has been sort of rapid, you know, in that time frame. It's become very popular, and I would certainly agree that it's, you know, hitting mainstream status, you know, in the sense that we see, you know, real sort of big established businesses, you know, like a Microsoft is a platinum sponsor here, right? So that's sort of indicative of the traction that the platform has. But the interesting thing is that certainly over the last year, as I said, one of the phenomenon that we've observed is, you know, Node sort of hitting that sort of quote-unquote trough of disillusionment, you know, in the sense that, you know, there were a couple articles that came out, one of them being sort of Node causes cancer and, you know, all these sorts of negative backlash types pieces. This process usually takes a lot longer. It usually takes sort of multiple years to sort of come in and
to reach that trough?
To reach it, but also to go through it.
They're going through it.
I think you could sort of argue, you know, to what extent you know they're through it or not. But certainly from our perspective, we haven't seen quite that same coverage. So you know, I would make the argument that you know we may in fact have spit back out the other side. And have already sort of traversed that trough of disillusionment, which, you know, if that ends up, you know, proving true, you know, it has to be one of the sort of quickest times that's ever happened.
Huh.
Well, I mean, everything about Node is happening quicker than
that's right.
than most other frameworks in history. I mean, the releases come faster,
that's
like,
right.
platform as a service sprung up faster. I mean, everything around it is probably moving faster than anything I think I've ever seen.
Yes.
So would you see that in your data, that the ecosystem in general is growing as fast as Node?
Yeah.
Or is Node
growing
faster than the rest of the ecosystem?
It is. So our internal metrics at Redmonk, you know, we measure sort of traction on our content. We, you know, look at a variety of different sources, you know, GitHub, Stack Overflow, a variety of different developer communities. Node basically crushes, you know, really any of the other technologies that we cover. You know, and this is, you know, really, I'd have to go back and actually look, but I think it's over an 18-month period. It's still, you know, occupying three of the top five spots, you know, in terms of our internal metrics.
Really?
So it's always performed very well. The interesting thing is that it's not just Node. You know, and I mentioned this when I was on stage yesterday, that if you go and look at the number of modules that have been created and add-ins that have been created around the platform in a very short span of time, you know, community traction and support for the platform is really just remarkable.
What are the other two? You said, you know, it's in the top three.
Oh, three of the top five. Yeah, it's a good question. I honestly don't know. I'd have to go. I mean, and a lot of it depends on, are we looking at 18 months? Are we looking at a six-month slice?
Right.
You know, because if I remember right, I think in 2010, at least one, if not two of the other two were associated with the Oracle and Google lawsuit around Java,
mm-hmm.
you know, because that was very much top of mind for a lot
right.
of developers that we speak with and so on. But again, it just, it really looks at, it depends heavily on, you know, which precise time frame we're taking a look at.
Well, the world weaves in strange and mysterious ways, doesn't it? And Twilio has adopted Node.js.
So we don't use it internally, but we have adopted it.
Through your developer community.
Right, through the ecosystem. Like, we're trying to support it as well as anything else that we support. I mean, we love HTTP in all forms, and you know, Node is the current hotness when it comes to HTTP, so we want to make sure that we have all of the resources there that we can to provide Node developers the same class experience as everyone else.
How do you see it as the current hotness?
It's really sprung up in like our support requests or what we see at hackathons with what people are building with. A lot of people will start new projects these days and use Node. It's as common as anything else. Our unofficial community contributed helper library has as many GitHub watchers as our Python library does. So the Python library has been around for a couple of years now, and it's matured, and the Node one has sprung up just about a year ago, I think. I mean, it's really just taken off. So like, we see it in all sorts of different areas where we're starting to have to make sure that we have the knowledge on our end to make sure that we support the people that want to use it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's interesting. I mean, you know, you think about GitHub, right? And everything is just faster, though, to some extent, isn't it? Everything is just, you can just do things so much faster than you ever could before.
Yeah.
And it seems like that Node.js has that combination effect where the level, the skill sets, you still need good skill sets, but there is a much lower barrier to entry. Isn't there? Are you finding that?
Barrier to entry, I mean, yes, to some
it's
extent.
JavaScript, people who know how to JavaScript.
I think one of the interesting things to me about Node is the fact that there are a variety of sort of frameworks that are associated with languages. You know, and we've all heard of, you know, things like Rails and Django and, you know, all these other language frameworks that are very popular, Spring for Java. The interesting thing to me about Node is that it is really fundamentally sort of a different approach, you know, in terms of sort of pushing a, you know, an asynchronous model, which is, you know, just a different way of doing things. So I think in terms of making it easy to use, you know, one of the things that it attempts to solve, and really for certain workloads, right, this isn't across the board, but it attempts to sort of ease the pain of, you know, trying to sort of build applications at scale for data-driven workloads, you know, bit-driven workloads and so on, you know, by, you know, essentially trying to take, you know, problems of concurrency out of the equation. Right?
Well, the problems of concurrency seem to be one of the issues.
I'm sorry?
Concurrency, we were just talking with Theo of... he has a big consulting firm. He does a Surge conference.
Yeah.
Theo
Schlossnagel, yep.
And he was talking about the issues with that is one of the issues with Node.js is concurrency because you can run into trouble a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, as I said, it takes a different approach, right? I mean, it's single-threaded by nature.
Right.
In other words, that's the sort of model that it prescribes. That's the model that, basically it implements, you know, as part of the framework. So it's, you know, as I mentioned before, it's very appropriate for certain workloads, is less appropriate for other workloads, and it just depends on, all right, what are you trying to do? Because, yeah, I mean, I think for a certain class of workload, it definitely lowers the barrier to entry, makes things easier.
Great.
I mean, along those same lines, like, one of the things that Node really excels at is that you don't need to, like, have some separate skill, some corresponding skill to go with it. Like, for instance, you want to get started in PHP, you have to configure Apache and get that set up. You can't just start with PHP and run it standalone yet. In the next version, they're going to embed a web server. But the fact that Node is a web server or can be a web server, sort of, they put an entire working example on their front page that you can copy and paste. You download it, you just do that, and you're running. You don't need a separate configuration thing like that. And I think that makes it really easy for people to tinker with and toy with. And we found, especially with our API, which is also easy to tinker with and toy with, that's really a really strong catalyst for people building bigger and better things that aren't tinkering and toying. That the lower it is and the less ceremony there is to get started, the more likely people will build a lot of things and that one of those ideas will take off and become something significant. And I think Node really hits on that really well.
Well, we've all been to these startup contests. And you can get pretty cynical about them because the companies there could be pretty bad, right? Yeah. But the companies here have actually been pretty impressive. I don't know what you guys think about it, but I've seen some companies up there that are doing some things that are actually really pretty cool.
Yeah, no, I totally agree.
Any favorites?
I wouldn't necessarily say they're favorites. I think two of the ones that interest me specifically, actually I just saw, are GeekList and Markover. And primarily because, you know, one of the things that, being a developer-focused firm, one of the things that we you know, sort of deal with, you know, certainly analyze and comment on and so on, is the difficulty for identifying resources. It's really difficult to hire. And hiring is, it doesn't matter how big your company is, how many people you have dedicated to it, it's a tremendously difficult process.
Right.
So a lot of sort of, a lot of companies are turning to things like GitHub to try to do it more quantitatively, because at the end of the day, a resume is not terribly useful for assessing programmer skill. So, you know, having these resources like a Geek List or in this case, a Markover, you know, for the design side of the crowd, you know, those are going to be interesting, I think, you know, purely for, I mean, yes, they're useful to the people that use them, but from my perspective as an analyst, they're going to be just as useful for, all right, how do I, you know, sort of more quickly and efficiently identify resources that I might want to work with or hire?
Markover was pretty impressive. I mean, we don't really see many tools like that that are meant for the design community.
And did you catch the bit, the note some of people just tweeted this, that that's a senior in college, that girl who presented.
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
Yeah, totally, she goes to Notre Dame or something.
Yeah, that's great. Good for her.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
I think Markover is like sort of on the precipice of what like seems to be a lot of people are working on, is that like the next generation of real-time collaboration, right? And she had the Skype window overlaid, you know, next to the annotation for the video in the audio chat. But like, it doesn't really make sense for that to be separate. Well, that should be in every application. Every app should be empowered to build real-time communication into the apps. I mean, that's what we're trying to tackle. And I mean, she really like illustrated how powerful that was, that we were going to collaborate. We were going to zoom in on these 10 pixels and talk about it over video. And we want to enable another generation of apps to do that. And I think we're really just on the front doorstep of of things like Node and things like Twilio enabling those types of apps to be even more powerful.
And it had, you know, and it had kind of a sense of an activity stream integrated into it as well, which is just very easy to look at and very easy to, you know, and then be able to look at the designs themselves. Well, I think we're getting pretty close to our time here, so I want to thank you guys both for spending, you know, a few minutes just chatting about Node.js, and we'll talk to you guys soon.
All right, thanks, Alex.
Thanks.
Awesome.
Thanks, Steven.
Cheers.
All right, well, we're here live at Node Summit. I'm Alex Williams of SiliconANGLE. We'll be right back.
Okay, we're back live in San Francisco, California for Node Summit, the event where Node.js is front and center, the first Node Summit's inaugural conference. I'm John Furrier, the founder of SiliconANGLE, with Alex Williams from SiliconANGLE, with our next guest, Glenn Loheed. Welcome to theCUBE.
Thank you.
So you're working on some pretty exciting stuff around DevOps. We just launched today our new vertical publication called DevOps Angle, where we're going to be doing in-depth coverage of DevOps and, as was pointed out earlier, Ops Dev, depending upon where you come from.
Exactly.
you have an interesting development around automation. And it's a big area, you know, configuration management, automation, making all that stuff work automatically. Self-healing networks are out there, and you got all issues around, you know, provisioning and deploying. Big hot button.
Yep.
Give us kind of the state of the union around the marketplace and what you're developing.
Well, for us, we tend to integrate with the technologies that are in that space. So, like the Puppet, the Chef, the NStratus guys. Really, our specialty is more in the monitoring side. So, really, we integrate well with those guys because what we're doing is we're providing the visibility into the server and some of the application services to be able to trigger those automation programs.
But one question I have is about, you know, your tools and such, and looking at IT today. And mm-hmm. IT today, you know, is not, the people are not trained really for this new environment as much.
Yeah.
Where's the disconnect? Where are you starting to see some, you know, some abilities for, you know, for this new adoption to really take off?
Well, I think the thing is that where we've seen is that, and for us, the hardest sell for our product is sort of the server admin guys that are over the age of 35, because they're so used to products like Cacti and Nagios from a monitoring perspective. So it's hard for them to really get over that hump that, oh, there's something new that can automate this stuff for me, right? But we've seen sort of all the younger guys being able to adopt this stuff very quickly, and partially because they don't have the sort of decades of experience within that server environment.
Mm, right.
And as the infrastructure as a service has come forward more and more and more, running a server is really getting easier. So, you know, the ability for those guys to dig into that server isn't as necessary. So that's really where those experience came from those older guys, is that, you know, they actually had to get there. They actually had to go down to the rack and start pulling through this stuff, right? So that's where we, you know, for us, that's where we see the opportunity, is being able to provide much easier solutions for these guys.
So, like you're saying, John, DevOps and Ops Dev, right?
Yep.
I mean, like the older guys are trying to say, hey, what the heck is this stuff?
We got systems guys, and we heard from Theo Schlossnagel, who's Ops, bringing up the devil's advocate side of it, is that, you know, Ops and systems, you can't, they aren't supposed to break.
Nope.
Code breaks, code says bugs, and they kind of, you know, iterate, and, you know, developers, and iterate.
Yep.
But, you know, you're running systems all day long, you know, there's a little conflict there. So, you know, that's where automation really makes sense, right? So how do you make things more reliable in that dynamic environment of configuration and management?
Well, I think the thing is that, you know, that's where, you know, companies like us and those guys from like Chef and Puppet and InStratus can really help, right? Is that we can provide all of that opportunity to make those things happen for them, right? Whereas then they can really focus on the application itself.
Well, let's talk about your product. So tell the folks out there what you guys do and what you make, and specifically just tell them what the product is, then we can talk about some of the use cases.
So what we do is we're a hosted monitoring service. So we look at the machine level, the OS, as well as the application services layers, and we pull all that data back, process it, create some derivative metrics, start to visualize it for these individuals, and then you can put all of your alerts on it, and be able to be monitoring very quickly. And so for us, what we do in our specialty really is that we have a single line install. So it's a wget or curl command, and what that does is that gets embedded into stuff like Puppet and Chef and Stratus, and allows you to be able to spin these things up and then be monitoring, and that's really our specialty, be able to be monitoring those instances from within 45 seconds of them being spun up. So that's really...
And who's buying this thing right now? Who's using it? Where are you at in terms of the company?
Okay, so we've just sort of launched publicly. We've gotten a bunch of partners with us, including Joyant, that we've, you know, we're partnering with to push our product out there. The base of our product and a lot of the development came from a bunch of social game developers. So those guys really have that issue where it's like, we got to spin this stuff up and spin it down because we're dealing with sort of that dinner hour crunch on their game. So really they don't need those 50 servers the whole time, but during, you know, a specific time when people come home and start playing that game.
Come home from school.
Exactly. Well, partially, yes.
Yeah, I mean.
So they get crunched. And yeah. But they really want to be able to monitor at the same time, be able to be pulling the statistics back off of those servers. But using traditional solution stuff that was built in the 90s, like Nagios was first released, was 1999. So those technologies don't work in those environments. And so that's really where we see our opportunity is to fit in and innovate in that area.
So tell me about the fit with, tell me a little bit more about the fit with Puppet and Chef and Anstratus.
Okay.
Can you explain that?
So simply like the thing about Puppet and Chef and Anstratus, those guys are automation. So really what they're looking at is making it really easy for you to deploy your network, be able to manage those things, be able to put updates and push updates through to those guys. So what we do is that we've got the simple one line that can be part of like the recipe with Chef, or part of your configuration with Puppet, and it's that simple to get monitoring. Whereas before, you know, monitoring was tons of configuration, setting up your processing server. We take care of all of that.
Okay, so it's all taken care of. And again, who are like the core audience that you're trying to reach right now?
I would say for us, the easiest sell tends to be on the DevOp and not necessarily the op dev.
Yeah, I would say so.
the thing is that the guys that are traditional hardcore sysadmin operator type guys, they're a little bit harder sell because they're used to very traditional technologies in this way.
We saw a lot of greatness come out of with Amazon. Obviously, the whole history of Amazon is, you know, pretty significant. You know, saw RightScale come out with that front end, made it easier. And then now, as we move into the cloud, some front ends like Puppet and Chef and others are creating that simple environment.
Yes.
What's changed, or anything's changed over the past 3 years in this market? It's been pretty dynamic from what I could see. Not a lot of proven solutions. It's evolving. Can you share with us your vision of, or can you share with us your view of what happened over the past 3 years in terms of that market change and kind of what's in front of you?
Well, I think that's the thing. I think we've seen, several years ago, we were still in a phase where your business would grow organically. And so your growth curve would obviously still be in that sort of L shape. But unlike today, where we've seen sort of viral and social growth, and moving from being able to, you know, gain 1,000 users to being able to gain 10,000, 20,000, 100,000, a million users in a day, you know, these products have had to evolve to deal with those situations. And that's where that sort of automation has come in. And those guys have really had to focus on being able to make sure that they can scale and work within that environment.
Has the number one issue been provisioning servers and networks, or all the above, or any one area that's jumping out at you, or is it?
Yeah, I mean, provisioning is definitely an ongoing sort of concern, and that's where I think we fit in really well, is that we can provide the monitoring as they continue to provision.
So what's the Node.js angle for you guys?
So for us, there's sort of two components. We're a user of Node. It functions within our system as our internal API, so pulling data from the processing layer into our UI. We also use it for our external API, so anybody wants to pull data out of our system, they can do it via Node.js. You know, as it turned out and as it sort of became like this cool little virus within our organization, one of our developers said, we had a feature that people really wanted, which was sort of this network connections, TCP, SSH, HTTP. So he prototyped it very quickly in Node, and it turned out to be so stable that we just kind of kept it that way. So it's been continually creeping in as we've been using it forward. And then on the second angle is that with our partnership with Joyent, we're pulling via their API the dtrace data that's being coming out of Node.js on the HTTP layer. Mm-hmm. So we're grabbing that, starting to visualize it, and allowing people to put alerts on it.
So you're one of the tools that's integrating into dtrace, though.
I mean, that's definitely one part of what we do, absolutely.
Well, that's what they were talking about. They say that there needs to be more tools available around dtrace.
Yeah, and I think we're going to continue to keep innovating in that area. I think that there's so much opportunity with the amount of sheer data that dtrace can pull out, because we tend to look at stuff a little bit more in the 10,000 foot level. If you look at how amazing the stuff that Joyent's doing on the dtrace side, it's like grain of sand compared to the 10,000 foot level. So it's sometimes it's really overwhelming to look at. But if right. you can get the alert at the higher level and right. then dig in, I think it's really valuable.
Right. So, for I guess if I can see why you're using Node.js, it seems like it caught on very quickly. But what are some of the other, you know, real reasons why you're using it?
Well, the thing was is that we weren't completely sold. And within our API, we actually started A-B testing. So we A-B tested against PHP, we A-B tested against Python within our internal API. And it just turned out that, that Node was actually the most effective data mover for us. So, you know, we tested it, and it proved itself to be the best solution for us. So for us, that's really why we jumped on. It was just the best solution.
So... do you have any funding? Are you funded yet?
We've been bootstrapping and doing it ourselves.
What's your background?
All over the place.
Tell us a little
bit.
Come
on, share. Tell us.
Well, it's mostly on the creative industry side. So I did a bunch of movies and a bunch of television series and music videos.
Tell us some of your.
You're a natural for theCUBE. What do you think of theCUBE? What do you think about this?
The lights are very bright. I did a ridiculous amount of filmed entertainment. But the thing was, is during that whole time, I was always trying to push on the new media side. And on the gaming side. And I was one of the guys that helped create this TV show called Electric Playground, which is a show that reviews video games. And it was really interesting because it's actually one of the first television shows to evolve out of a web property. So we started with the web property and then moved into film and television. So I started as a web guy and then moved into filmed entertainment. And then as I sort of moved through film and entertainment, I started moving back into web and gaming. So... my last company was a company called Dime Rocker, which we tried to create this really cool platform to deliver 3D games to Facebook. And I think we were just a little bit ahead of the curve on that one. And then during that whole experience, we couldn't get the statistics out of our servers. And so it kind of evolved into me finding a way to be able to pull the metrics out of our servers to be able to monitor them.
So thus DevOps, but you know, you began the DevOps journey.
Yes.
We talk about on theCUBE here, we take all the other events, the big data events, where there's no, in the big data world, the discipline is interesting. You have a lot of creative meets math jocks
yes.
to programmers, all kind of rolled into one.
Yes.
So you have that interesting talent, it's not just pure developer. So it's the new skill set, right?
Well, yeah.
Being versatile.
It was really interesting because it was. I flowed from web to like that creative industry stuff and then back from that creative industry right back into web.
Well, Hollywood to the Valley to Hollywood to the Valley.
Yeah, but I'm in Vancouver, so it's from
Vancouver
north.
That's a big film hub. That's a big film hub.
It's a massive film hub.
Yeah.
Yeah,
So my final question, Glenn, is what's next? What do you see out in front of you? Obviously, you got a startup, you're bootstrapping it, you probably generate some cash or financing, however that comes in. What's next for you? How do you see this market evolving? What's the vision?
Well, I continue to see how the sort of social and viral growth is going to continue to affect how businesses are built. And I think for us, we just want to be able to help those businesses grow and have them focus more on the application and keeping it stable as they grow, and then for us, just being there to support them through the monitoring side.
Well, great to chat with you, Glenn.
Glenn
Loheed here inside theCUBE. We're live at Node Summit, where all the action's happening, the first conference of its kind, inaugural conference around Node.js. Real successful framework with JavaScript, doing well, great performance. Thanks so much for coming to theCUBE, and we'll be right back in 5 minutes.
Thanks.
First time on theCUBE, baby. Rock and roll.
Well, I think it's probably 5 or 6 times I've been on theCUBE now. Right, you know, at first, the guys are just fun to work with.
Pat, welcome back.
Hey, always a pleasure to be in theCUBE.
Hey, I'm about to go on theCUBE. You never know what's going to happen. I'm, a 3-time veteran of being on theCUBE. I hope many, many more.
Chad Sakic, Chad, welcome to theCUBE. Dave, John, it's great to be here, man.
I keep coming back because great insightful questions from John and from Dave.
What face-melting action have you seen here at the event? And I know there's a lot of it.
It's a great vehicle to communicate with a broad audience. A lot of folks watch.
Great to have you back. Good job.
All right, Craig Nunez, VP of Marketing at HP Storage. Thanks very much for coming on theCUBE.
When people mention theCUBE, they're like, oh my God, I saw you on theCUBE. And they're all excited about it. It's an experience. It's not just information. They experience kind of what's going on there. It's like real time. It's like they were there.
That was like
my
going to the
pleasure.
Gym. Boom, boom.
Legendary IBMer, CEO of Symantec, and now CEO of Virtual Instrument. Great to have you on theCUBE.
So for CUBE to be here at a conference like this that's got 15, 20,000 people and sharing that live around the world, that's consistent with the way the world is evolving. So it's a wonderful medium, wonderful medium.
John and Dave are amazing. I don't know how they keep everything in their heads the way they do. It's a great format, and we're obviously seeing that this notion of real-time coverage and a real conversation is what's driving us as a company. And I say it very seriously when the questions and the comments that we hear from them and from all the different guests here directly turn into the products that we build.
Yeah, that was my first CUBE, and I really enjoyed it. There was the rapid fire of questions. It made me think on my feet, but they were very thought-provoking and really got me going on analyzing the greatness of Arista and the greatness of theCUBE as well.
John and Dave, the reason their approach works, they're not just guys, you know, reading down the question list, right? Okay, next one. It's a conversation, right? And it's, you know, they're going to challenge you. They're not going to settle for the marketing hype and the BS and all that stuff that the industry throws around.
Come on, you got to hit him up on the HP question. A lot's changed at HP. Some turmoil at the top, obviously, controversy.
They're going to hold you down to the real facts, compare you to the choices our users have, and have you respond to it on the spot, right? Thinking real time. And so that's real talk, not just kind of a paper interview, I think.
I'm John Furrier with SiliconANGLE.com, and I'm here with Dave Vellante. We are inside theCUBE. theCUBE is our flagship telecast. We go out to the events, extract all the signal from the noise, and share that with you. And great guest lineups. We've got CEOs, CTOs, with all the top executives, bloggers, thought leaders, venture capitalists.
I'm absolutely stunned because I know it demands 100% attention for these guys to be up there talking to people about a wide variety of technology topics. I can't believe these guys can make it so many days in a row. So I'm wondering how long they're going to go home and pass out for after this. But it was incredible. They just do a fantastic job.
If you're not having a conversation, then you're very scripted. And if you're scripted, then you might be getting the right words, but you're often not getting the whole meaning and the whole depth of the conversation to the fullest extent. I think this is a heck of a lot more authentic. It comes straight from the heart and the brain. Sometimes you might forget to make some of your points if you're not a real-time thinker. But I think from a participation and from a consuming point of view, it's much more real.
Chris holds no punches.
So I've been on theCUBE a number of times, and I think the interesting thing about being in that particular venue in that format, they introduced me as, hey, Hoff doesn't pull punches. Well, they don't either, right? They ask really difficult, uncomfortable questions sometimes, and you can tell people and the positions and where they are in terms of what they're able or desirous to speak of. You can tell where they are on that borderline between kind of just, you know, honestly answering questions versus kind of glossing over them. And I enjoy being there because I don't want to say I'm outspoken, but I honestly answer questions with the full intent of being able to be respectful to the people that I bring solutions to, right? If I whitewash this crap, you're gonna turn me off every single time you see me on any venue, let alone theCUBE. So I like being asked tough questions. I like answering them honestly, and that's a fantastic venue for doing it. Otherwise, you get on panels and you got a bunch of talking heads blabbing at each other, and it's worthless.
Yeah, this was my first time on theCUBE, and I really got a chance to get to know John and Dave, and they're really amazing guys. I mean, the knowledge that they come with, the topics that they could talk about, the people that they know, and just bringing it all together in this live broadcasting forum is just fantastic. I mean, I just love it. I feel like a groupie or something, you know?
In this environment, you know, the social environment, the real-time environment where we're in, right, people look through the marketing fluff very quickly. And if it's not authentic, right, you know, they don't trust it anymore. So in this environment, I think it's a growing trend.
Yeah.
Hello, hi, I'm Alex Williams of SiliconANGLE here at Node Summit on theCUBE. We do a tech event coverage like no one else. I'm here today with a fine gentleman from, what's the name of your company? Can you tell us a little about what you know, who you are and what you're doing here?
Sure. My name is Sachin Anand. I am the founder and CEO of WebMobi. WebMobi is a cloud-based app platform for creating smartphone and tablet applications using HTML5 and Node.js. So we enable creation of scalable mobile apps that can work across all different smartphones platforms, as well as available via a cloud-based URL.
So we were talking a little bit before you came, you know, on the show, and you're talking about the app creation, I mean, actually building apps. Where is that marketplace right now? Can you tell us a little bit about where the, you know, where the market is right now? I mean, we've seen this real increase in apps and people are deploying them by the millions. What is it that's missing?
So HTML5 has been getting a lot of traction since 2011, and now we are at a transition point where now we have three different smartphone platforms which are getting a lot of traction, and developers really want to create apps which are working with a single code base across all these three platforms and the other legacy platforms as well. So I think that inflection point is there, where now we'll see a lot of transition to HTML5 based development approach, where we can use some of the SaaS platforms like WebMobi to create apps that can work across platforms.
Yeah. So how does your platform work? It sounds like you have a GUI for creating the GUI. So, you know, like is it sort of a drag and drop application creation environment?
Yes. So what happens is, like, you go to our website, webmobi.com, create an account, log in, and then you have a UI editor. So in the UI editor, as you can create a UI, which where as you're creating the UI, you can see how it's going to look like on different phones. And then you can define connectors which connect to our Node.js based backend to create a scalable app. For example, like you have 1,000 users that you want to register, so you can define a user object and that you can link with our front end UI. And then we have also built certain connectors for most of the popular web services. So you can say add a social component, Twitter, YouTube, etc. And then you can actually create an app rapidly with all these three things together. And these apps are really scalable, so they can cater not only to, say, 1,000 users, but also to 1,000,000 users, because we are using cloud-based approach and create apps from there.
How are you using Node.js?
So Node.js, what we are, we have on our backend is entirely based on Node.js. So we create these REST API endpoints that allows a web developer to create a client-side JavaScript code that is working across all platforms. So we use those REST APIs that are talking to our Node.js backend and using that. And plus, we're also using connectors. Those connectors are also talking to other web services using Node.js.
Why'd you choose Node.js?
So, in terms of we are a startup, early stage startup, and one of the big challenges is to unify the development environment where we are using HTML5 on the client side, HTML5 and JavaScript, and then we also want to use the same technology on the server side, and it really enables us to scale faster, where our team and myself, we do development both on the client side as well as we can switch over to the server side. So that is one advantage. And then Node.js is really, in terms of performance, it's really optimal, asynchronous, and really fast to deploy. And some of the tools that are coming up are also, like Express.js is really awesome, and it's really fast to develop compared to some of the legacy technologies.
How complex are the apps that people can make with WebMobi? Can you give us an example of something that someone's built?
Sure. So We have built certain apps, like for example, one of the apps that is there is where a mobile app where a user can user account is created and then user can upload their content, whether it's a photo, videos, and they're stored in our in the backend, and then it can be accessed via the mobile device, and then you can do certain things with those apps. So that is one use case where you can have a cross-platform content access mobile portal where you can access that content across from different mobile devices. That is one use case. And then, of course, I think one other huge use case is where to the point where a lot of publishers have the existing web content and they want to have a mobile presence of their web content, so they can decide, okay, this is what they want to have on the mobile, and they can import that content from using their existing web content. So that is the second use case.
How much programming background does somebody need to have in order to use this? Do they need to know JavaScript?
So that's a good point. So we have a different tiered business model, as well as we have different levels of usage. So for a small and medium business, they can just use our pre-built components and create mobile apps. Those mobile apps will just be talking to existing web services, and they might have certain cookie cutter approach, like storing form data, etc., that they can rapidly build. But then for medium businesses to enterprise level, we have Node.js components that they can further develop and upload on a server, and that requires definitely JavaScript and knowledge both mostly on the client side. And because we are using a packager, hybrid apps are packaging those client-side JavaScript, so that enables developers to just know JavaScript and not too much focus on the mobile-specific intricacies.
So we just have a few minutes left. Perhaps we could just end this conversation with giving us a little bit summary of what's next for your company. Do you have? Are you seeking funding? What are your plans for the coming year?
Great. So we launched our paid service today itself. So we want to scale and further grow and acquire customers both at the enterprise and business level. And definitely we are looking for funding to further expand and rapidly acquire businesses. We also want to focus on certain verticals that allow us to create a niche, and that we are going to be announcing more in couple of months, and focus on that and then expand from there.
Well, great. Well, thank you very much for taking some time.
Thanks a
really
lot.
Appreciate it.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, we'll be right back in a few minutes. I'm Alex Williams, SiliconANGLE, here with Clint Finley, also SiliconANGLE. See you in a few minutes.
Welcome back to Node Summit live from San Francisco, California. I'm John Furrier, the founder of SiliconANGLE.com and SiliconANGLE.tv. And this is theCUBE, our flagship telecast, where we go out to the events, live stream, and talk to the smartest people we can find, entrepreneurs, thought leaders, executives, venture capitalists, and extract the knowledge and share that with you. And I'm joined with Clint Finley, the editor of DevOps Angle, which we launched today. And we're here at Node Summit, the inaugural conference for Node.js. And we try to talk to the smart people, and sometimes we get the inventors. And we're here with Ryan Dahl, the inventor of Node.js. Ryan, welcome to theCUBE.
Hello. Hi.
Okay, so we've interviewed Doug Cutting in the past, inventor of, creator of Hadoop. You created Node.js, obviously huge success. We had a chance to talk on a Monday night at the Thirsty Bear and told some of the story, but really want to say just congratulations for just doing some great work, and it's evolved into its own budding ecosystem and industry. So I want to first say congratulations.
Thanks.
So tell us the story of Node.js. Why did it all came together for you? Just for us, tell the folks kind of how it all started and take us through the life of how it all began.
What problem were you trying to solve originally?
So I guess the original problem was a long time ago when people were trying to figure out how to do uploads via HTTP. And it used to be that if you uploaded a file, you would kind of post to the form, and it would just kind of freeze up on you. You wouldn't get any interaction. Maybe at best you get a little spinny dial or something. But these days you get a progress bar that kind of says how much you're uploading. And at some point, like I would guess 2006 or so, I saw a demo in probably Flickr, although I can't remember exactly. Where they actually showed this. You would post an image and you saw the progress bar like going in. It's just like blown away. Like, oh my God, how do they do that? And you would think like, oh, the web browser obviously is sending a file via some socket to some server. The web browser obviously knows how much of the file has been sent, so it's exposed by the DOM. But it's actually not exposed client side to the user. The way that these progress bars are is that as you're uploading a file, you reach around on the side and ask the server, you know, how much have I uploaded? How much have I uploaded? And the server responds, okay, 3%, 5%. And so in this way, the user can kind of see how far the progress bar is going, how the upload is going. Solving this doing this sort of thing in the web stacks that were around at the time is difficult because it requires handling multiple requests at the same time, right? You're somebody's uploading this file that could be going on for several minutes, and you at the same time you have this extra request coming in that you know needs to respond at concurrently to the upload. It turns out that a lot of the frameworks were designed in a way that they made the assumption that you know a request response is something that kind of happens instantaneously, and that your entire web development experience should be abstracted in as a function that you get a request and you return a response, and that is the extent of your context. So Node was originally born out of this problem and thinking about this, and how can you handle these two things at the same time? And obviously there's many different ways of doing this, but non-blocking sockets is one way. And so Node is more or less the idea that exploring the idea of what if everything was non-blocking? What if you never waited for any I/O to happen? You just use only non-blocking I/O. What falls out of that, and pairing that with JavaScript. And turns out you can make a web upload progress bar with this, so among other things. But it basically comes out of the, it turns out a lot of problems can basically be summed up as this, you know, sort of interactive websites where you need to do more than one thing at a time, whether it's a chat where, you know, one person sends a message and you broadcast it out to everybody else, or if it's a game where you're moving around and you need to relay those movements to other people, it's all more or less the same problem. As long you need a programming environment that somehow abstracts, it gives you the right abstraction for dealing with all of these different events happening.
When did you see Node start to really get the lift up? And obviously you're ticking around, you're playing with Node, doing these things you're mentioning. When did it kind of start clicking? You're like, wow, this is really going on.
So in early 2009, I had this idea. I was like, okay, JavaScript and non-blocking I/O, great. Let's put those together and see if we can build something useful with it. I worked on that for about 6 months, maybe a bit less, four months or so, before I had like a demo that I could start using. And kind of as I was developing this, I built a chat application at the same time. So kind of with the framework, I was building this chat thing. And after some time, I just realized like, wow, this is like, you know, 200 lines of code, and I've got this chat server, and it's purely JavaScript. There's nothing other than JavaScript in here. And it's just like, oh wow, this is actually, you know, going from something, it just kind of playing around with the idea, neat idea, kind of academic maybe even, but to something where you realize that, holy crap, you can actually build things in a reasonable amount of time with this.
So what was the performance like at that time? You're like, wow, this is actually fast.
Yeah, it was good enough to handle tens of clients and, you know, have no lag basically. So good enough. Performance with Node, we spent a lot of time making sure that we're not doing anything overly stupid inside of it. So we care about performance a lot. Turns out that original the 10x improvement that we got by doing non-blocking I/O, that was the big choice. Since then, we've been trying to explore other ways of doing performance. But you know, and we've gotten some wins here and there. But more or less, the performance has been the same since the original design.
Right, so what happened next? Okay, you got to show people this, right? So like, hey, you call your best buddies up and say, hey, look at this.
Right. So at this time, like JavaScript, I think these days it's recognized as kind of a language, but a couple of years ago it was not really that way, right? It was this weird browser thing, but it was just beginning to be recognized as, you know, Crockford came out with this book, JavaScript, The Good Parts, and people started thinking, oh, you know, actually, this is actually a programming language. People, you could actually design programs with it. Gmail was written. You had these big complex applications being written in JavaScript, and with that, some sort of respect for the language. So the JS Conf was created by Chris Williams in 2008, I believe. And the European version of that came out in 2009. And so I wrote them, and I was like, oh, I got this demo. I really want to show this off at your conference. And they wrote back, and they're like, yeah, sure. You know, got me a slot there. And so I finally showed it off at this European conference. And it went really well. I gave
it was a standing ovation. Wasn't there?
Yeah, supposedly. that's what they tell me. I was extremely nervous. I mean, I had been working on this thing for just like many months, and I was like super nerdy about it. And it's just like I had been practicing my presentation for like weeks before that. It's just like very, very wanting to show off, you know, what I meant by this, because I felt like if I started talking about non-blocking I/O and blah blah blah, everybody's just going to like zone out entirely. What was great was that I had a demo of a IRC server written in Node, so people could connect with non-web browsers, just with their IRC clients, and connect to the Node IRC server and start chatting. And which, thank God, I mean, this demo worked, because I felt like the entire talk was very philosophical and kind of abstract. But then you see, like, oh, holy shit, here is an IRC server written in fucking JavaScript, and it's 400 lines of code, and this is something that kind of
blew people's mind.
Yeah, people are like, wow, that is really something new, actually.
Awesome. But
people have been doing JavaScript on the server side since the 90s. So what was it about V8 and Node.js that made the difference that now people are really excited about doing JavaScript on the server side?
Right. So, as you said, there's been a lot of server-side JavaScript. None of them have stuck. Several reasons. One, they kind of had this very traditional model of how you present the server to the user, right? This request response, you know, you get a request, you do a bunch of stuff, then you return the response, but you don't acknowledge the presence of other requests going on concurrently to you. So it has this very simplified model, which is fine and works, but was not enough of a differentiator from Ruby on Rails and Django and PHP to really mean anything to people. It was like, oh, cool, I could do it in JavaScript, but you know, I've got Rails here. It works fine. It's not that big of a deal to think in Ruby and in JavaScript. The other aspect was it was all in Rhino, which the JavaScript interpreter on top of the JVM, which is notoriously slow. And it wasn't until 2008 when Chrome came out that people started realizing that oh, wow, companies are putting a lot of effort into improving the JavaScript performance to the degree that you had, you know, the very professional teams working on these virtual machines. So now you have in 2008 Chrome comes out with V8, and you realize, oh wow, okay, so Google is really pushing JavaScript performance, and they see this as a way of dominating the market. If they can make JavaScript faster, people will start using their web browser because Gmail runs faster, and suddenly Mozilla is put on edge, and they have to now make their JavaScript their spider monkey Jaeger monkey stuff work faster, and suddenly it becomes this benchmarks contest. Microsoft as well needs to now step up its game and start making this fast, and then suddenly JavaScript is faster than Ruby and Python, like basically overnight, and so it seems like in 2008, this is a very good language to start investing in. You get very good compute performance out of it.
And so it was at JSConf. You presented all this at JSConf. Here's Node.js. Here's how it's different from the old server-side stuff. And that's how it took off. It was just, people saw it there and just went nuts with it.
Yeah, as I said, I had been working on this for a long time, and by this conference, I was basically like out of money. Like I could no longer afford to work on this project full time, just on my own. So I went around looking for sponsors for the project so that I could continue to work on it. And various people were interested in doing this, and I went around and talked to a lot of people. But the most promising one came from Joyen. Who were like, oh, you know, we build this data center software, and what we want is we actually want Node to be used for our data center software. Like we don't really have an interest in monetizing Node itself, but we want our software to run well, and this is a perfect thing for building our own data center stuff, So this sounded great to me because little programs sitting there responding to events, little demons sitting around the data center doing various things sounded like a very good use case for Node. So I teamed up with Joyent and moved to San Francisco, and have been working on it full time since then. And it's just been kind of a constant progression of pushing this technology since then, fixing bugs and introducing it to new companies and convincing people and talking to them about it. And I think we've had a fairly good linear growth for 2 years or so, which is pretty crazy.
What have you learned, if you go for the folks out there who are always, open source is great for a lot of innovation. So what can you share with the other folks out there who are working on open source that work hard and you know, want to do a project, might have a success like a node, not directly competing, but you know what I'm saying, like, you know, people out there working hard, what can you share with them of lessons learned or things you wish you could get back and do differently or not do differently? What would you share with the folks out there working on some of these great new open source stuff?
I think there's a lot of people who feel, I think one thing that we've done very well in Node is integrate other people into the community and just be very open about what we're working on and trying to bring people into the project. So I've spent a lot of time, people will contribute a patch which is not necessarily appropriate for Node. Style is bad, you know, it's introduces other bugs, it's really big or whatever. It's some feature that I could hammer out in a couple minutes because I'm totally familiar with the code base, but I'll spend the next week going back and forth with these people saying, you know, okay, you know, fix this and fix that, and then they'll give me another revision. I'll say fix this and fix that, and just kind of going back and forth and talking about how they could get it into the code base. Because when you come to a new code base, when you're, you know, just a random person on the internet and you're contributing to an open source project, you don't know all of the things going on in that code base, right? So there's something that needs to.
You need to be stewardship.
You need to get introduced to it, and I think that a lot of projects will kind of reject these sort of contributions or not take the time to really integrate these people to it. But you know, if you do this and you spend a week with somebody and get their patch in and, you know, make sure that they're on the authors list and everything, then you have a person who now knows how the code base is going and can start contributing more.
So what you're saying, spend the time, embrace the people coming in who want to work.
Help people get involved and help show them how to contribute to the project. If they want to spend an hour of their time doing a patch for your project, you should spend a week of your time pulling them in, and hopefully you're going to get somebody who then contributes more.
That's great, and that's always great about community. It shows your commitment and socializes them into the project.
Yeah, I mean, the community of Node is really where it's at, right? The runtime itself is possibly nice, but you know, the community modules and all of the people that we have is what's important.
Okay, so now this is where I put you on the spot, and you could be political, and it's okay, I won't be offended if you don't say any names, but of all the companies here, which ones are your favorite? That you say, not from a company standpoint, but like coolness, like that's a cool thing of implementation of Node.
Okay, so the one that shocked me yesterday was Tile Mill, which is doing a mapping application. So you can make custom Google Maps type mapping applications with you know, data points and whatnot. But you can actually build these things locally on your desktop. So they made a Windows application using the Node port to Windows, have this desktop application with Node inside of it that allows you to kind of create a map and then generates this file that can then be uploaded to a server where they're hosting it, also with Node, and display these maps. So they have this great database of all these different maps that you can kind of overlay with each other and this great desktop product, and it just looks amazing. It's just something that, I don't know, I'm always amazed seeing these things. It's just like, wow, I would have never thought Node would be used.
Yeah, we actually had those guys on theCUBE yesterday, so anyone who's watching right now, you can find that interview. Yeah, Mapbox is the name of the company.
Mapbox?
Mapbox.
I thought it was the Tile Mill?
Tile Mill is the program, Mapbox is
the
company. Yeah,
okay.
And yeah, you can find our interview with them on SiliconANGLE TV.
Yeah, and we also talk with Voxer too, which is getting a lot of traction as well. What do you think of those guys?
Oh yeah, so Voxer is our biggest customer, so to speak. Because they are just pushing massive amounts of data through Node. They have this big distributed system with hundreds of Node instances doing voice over IP through this thing. So they have this walkie-talkie app. You click the button, you say, hey, what's up, blah, blah, blah. and it gets distributed to your followers. But voice, it goes up through Node and gets spread out and then down into React. And so they're just pushing massive amounts of data through Node. And they're finding problems. They just recently in November started really blowing up with many users. So they're finding a lot of our biggest problems at scale. So they'll find seg faults way before anybody else does, and so we're in close contact with Voxer. They are
quite impressive.
They're driving our kind of emergency fixes.
I think they're embedded in the code base. No, that's a great. We had Matt's great guy. We talked to him last night too. He shared some kind of inside baseball and some of the numbers, which we didn't talk about in the Cube. He wanted to respect his privacy, but. Very big success story, great growth there. So anything that surprised you here at this conference that you go, wow, not just companies.
I mean, the pure number. I mean, this conference was really about showcasing, what's going on and making sure that it's visible to, outside of the Node community, like the number of projects going on. And I of course, am in this community, and I've talked to a lot of these people here. But even so, like sitting there in the last session here and just seeing company after company after company,